He is literally wearing a spare tire around his middle. So the first question of the night sets the entire evening up. No pressure whatsoever.
It's actually two things.
Two questions.
Two questions, if that's all right.
Sir, you're playing on my sympathies, aren't you?
Well, my name's Andre. I'm an actor, comedian, and writer. People always try to get me to dance, too. My first question is, well, yes. I'm currently writing a screenplay now, and I've been at major writer's block for the longest time. I was wondering if you ever had writer's block and what you did to deal with it.
Have I ever had writer's block? Yeah, a little bit. I just basically don't have writer's block. I get writer's laze, where I just don't... Why should I write, you know?
Pretty much.
Let's see how many Law and Orders are on today. I do, basically, because I would rather sit there and watch Hang 'em High McCoy throw, you know, another scumbag murderer in jail than create shit. I want to be entertained sometimes, where it's just like, yeah, good, burn him. Fucking burn him. Send him to the goddamn chair. Murder one, eh? You know? And then my wife's like, yeah, the mortgage is due. I'm like, oh, shit. Jay and Bob say something remotely witty, you know? Cha-ching, back to Law and Order. So, I'll just kind of veg out and sit in front of the TV for a while, and it's not so much writer's block where I'm like, I have nothing. It's just this kind of place where I'm like, I don't want to do nothing. And I've only really had it maybe once. I was working on the $6 Million Man screenplay fucking eons ago, 1995, and there was this, we were working at Universal, on Mallrats, kind of, basically somebody, one of the producers, Jim Jackson, just like, hey, $6 Million Man is up for grabs. Somebody want to do a feature version. Did you ever watch it? And I was like, I did watch that show. And he was just like, you want to write it? And I was like, are you fucking kidding me? Not really, but... but it would be awesome to get the job, you know? Like, that's basically what it is for me. It's not doing the work. It's just having somebody go, you, sir, are good enough. And then I'm like, oh, phenomenal, thank you. And then I fucking fight it the whole way. Green Hornet, perfect example. It was just nice to have somebody say, you, sir, are good enough to make a comic book movie. And I was like, tremendous. And I signed the contract, and I was like, wait, what? Do it? So that kind of happened with $6 Million Man, and there were just days where I was like, I don't know what the fuck Steve Austin does, you know? What does he do? He wakes up and he watches Law and Order. Because I don't live the Steve Austin life, and I'm used to writing about shit where I just kind of take pages out of my own daily life and shit, but I am not bionic by any stretch of the imagination. Not even remotely athletic, you know? So I would be totally blocked writing that. And it really started to show. Like, I'd hand Mosier over some pages to read, Scott Mosier, my producer. And I was like, what do you think? And he was just like, well, in this scene here, the big action sequence, you have Steve Austin hiding behind a rock. And I was just like, dude's got to hide sometimes. I mean, it's not always, you know, sometimes... sometimes he's got to be on the down low and shit. And Mosier's like, and he's fighting 20 ninjas? I was like, not good. Bionic ninjas? So that one, it took me a long time to fucking write the script for. And I pitched it to one team of execs, who were then replaced by another team of execs. And then by the time I turned in my script, that second team of execs had been replaced by another team of execs. So I turned in my script to people going, are you kidding? This is your idea for a $6 Million Man movie? Motherfucker loses a leg and an arm, you give him robotics, and he hides behind a fucking rock? I was like, well, the first people really liked that idea. So, you know, the fucking never got made. And that was the last time I really got blocked, and ever since then, it's just kind of lazy. Because TV is kind of my kryptonite, right? Where it's just like, if it goes on, suddenly I'm like, I don't want to create, I just want to be entertained and shit like that. And having a kid, you watch a lot more TV than you normally watch, excuse me, before. Because back in the day, it was just like, Degrassi fucking reruns on tape and shit like that. I'm not pandering, that's true. And watch fucking Simpsons and porn. But later in life with the kid has like all sorts of programs that she likes to watch, and then you're kind of forced to watch them as well. And sometimes they're fucking insanely bad and really tough to sit through. There's this one fucking program she was watching the other day. And she was going to school. She watched TV before she goes to school. And I was, you know, went down there to say goodbye. And she goes, well, how you rolling? What's this? And she's like, this is rainbow fish. And I said, what's it about? And she kind of looked at me like, are you fucking retarded? Like, the title pretty much says it all. And and I peeped it out, and she was right, you know. It really is literally about a bunch of multicolored fish. And they go to school. Because, you know, fish travel in schools and shit. And that was the height of their fucking imagination. Just, let's put the rainbow-colored fish in school and fucking nobody's watching. Do it. So I was like, can't we watch something else? Let's pop in some fucking SpongeBob. She's like, no, rainbow fish. Rainbow fish. Because she was heading to school, so she wanted to see what they did. And then she'd take it to school with her and sit there and pretend to be a blue carp or something like that. I don't know. I don't know what goes through her head. But then there's some shit she watches where I'll get roped in. Like, at first I'm like, oh, this is fucking dog shit. But then you're like, this is actually pretty good. And the fucking show that she really turned me on to was this show called Dora the Explorer.